Plum Pudding Boot House. This is a real photograph. If we look out of the front door of the library, we can get nearly the same view down the Witton Lodge Road. You won't see a horse-drawn carriage today. For me, it asks the question, what is more real? This document, a photograph that was made in the 1930s as the library we sit in now was being built, or the images that live in our heads? When I look at this postcard, I think of running for the 28 bus to get to school, of how my friend Stuart Johnson lived in the corner house on the right-hand side, and we all thought he was posh because he had an extension, a garage, and his mum had a new Ford Escort every 3 years. These memories are particularly alive for me as I sit here in Perry Common Library. I learnt to read by reciting words from used tobacco tins in our family home on Enderby Road, which would have been just out of view at the end of this postcard. The house and the road no longer exist, but it is here in the library that I withdrew my first book, so you could say that we're back at the start of it all. The origins of this particular text and the reading I'm doing today, however, begin like so many things in 2020, with a long walk at a slightly awkward distance. Melanie Pocock was in the early stages of developing an exhibition around horror and modernist architecture for Ikon Gallery in Birmingham City Centre and was interested in how it might relate to some things that I was working on. As we walked through the near empty city centre, I started to sink into my memories of Birmingham, pointing out small architectural traces that triggered long forgotten histories, and also talking a lot about the way Birmingham had impacted, or perhaps more accurately infected, the way I read and experienced different cities. In the weeks and months that followed, I reflected on our conversation a lot and began to think about other, perhaps smaller ideas of horror. In Plum Pudding Boot House, I'll be talking about several buildings that have been or are important to me. I'm starting, however, with a story of a building that I've never been in and have no personal connection with. It's a ghost story of sorts. On June 15th, 1883, a correspondent for the Medium and Daybreak, a weekly journal devoted to the history and teachings of spiritualism, provided an account of his visit to Andrew Peterson in the Hampshire village of Sway during the construction of what remains the largest structure of unreinforced concrete in the country. On retirement, Peterson became an advocate and patron of the spiritualist movement in the UK and claimed to be building his tower under the instruction of the ghost of Sir Christopher Wren, better known as the architect of St Paul's Cathedral. In the Medium and Daybreak, we can read the prosaic manifestations of this. What breadth will you make your foundation? Asked the spirit. Well, I was thinking of making it 20 feet, a tenth part of the contemplated height that is 200 feet. Had you not better make it 24 feet, added the spirit, at the same time giving reasons for the recommendation. The chosen material for these foundations, concrete, is central to the stories that follow, as is a broader exploration of haunting, horror, and trauma. We'll leave Peterson's tower to consider. A mid-century art school in the English West Midlands. Birmingham Central Library. And the now demolished boot houses of Perry Common. These are the only photographs that I took of where I lived. The images on this contact sheet show the last remnants of Enderby Road and its concrete raised walkway. The concrete is long gone, and even the name of the road has disappeared from the map. The article on Wren's ghost in the Medium and Daybreak has itself something to say about concrete. But what is concrete, the reader may ask? The word signifies a compound or a combination. A plum pudding is undoubtedly concrete, and indeed the material of which we write bears not a little resemblance to that well-known and highly relished dessert. Part one. Boot House. 25 years after Peterson built his folly, a very different form of modernism was taking shape at Perry Common in North Birmingham, the council estate I lived on for the first 14 years of my life. The houses were built by the Henry Boot construction firm, with homes coming to be known affectionately as boot houses. The affection, like the houses, would soon begin to crack. It is said that the walls most likely to constrain us are the walls we build inside our heads. The walls that constrain me as a child can be traced on my skin in a literal sense, and the back of my head is a small cluster of scars. I don't know if I remember the incident and the injury itself or the retelling of it, a family story that gets told and embellished year after year. Me and my brother Ian, 5 years older than me, were playing army in the back garden. The play acting had moved on from the rattle of twig and stick machine guns to an interrogation against the exterior wall of the house. With one firm crack against the pebble dash that apparently reverberated through the concrete structure, I was given a lasting imprint of the house I grew up in. If I'd have had the information he was looking for, I'd have given it up gladly. I had an acute understanding of where I lived that transcended the knocking of my head into the exterior walls. I know that I lived in a boot house from time spent at community meetings, at MP surgeries, and through overheard conversations across the garden fence. I knew this because the boot houses were falling to pieces. It is no surprise that the sound of my head being smashed against the wall could be heard throughout the house. The pressing of a light switch was enough to start a cascade of loosed concrete behind the wood chip. My mum used to joke that if anybody ever tried to sell the house, the listing would say, "Close to the shops, getting closer every day." We arrived in 1981 from a masonette on a much worse estate called Topcroft, so the house was a big step up for us. But by the end of the decade, Perry Common and its sister estate, Pipe's, which coincidentally my auntie Josie, my mum's sister, lived in, had been condemned. It's worth noting that my mum and Josie were no strangers to upheaval. They'd grown up in Aston, just outside of the city centre, in the shadows of the HP sauce factory, in a back-to-back house. If you wish to see a traditional back-to-back, then you can visit the National Trust reconstruction in Birmingham city centre, but my mum says that it's a posh version. All of Birmingham's back-to-backs were demolished as part of the slum clearances of the 1960s. The site of my mum's old house is now the A38M, the Aston Expressway. Back to Enderby Road, where we would live until 1992. Plenty of time to acquire further scars. This mottled skin on my wrist is from a tumble off the one piece of play equipment in our junior school playground, a giant concrete saddle. This scar on my left hand is from an attempt to navigate the giant roundabout that known as the ring on a skateboard on my stomach, using my hands to stop. I've also broken my right wrist in Pericommon twice, but I couldn't get the x-rays to share with you. All of these injuries would precipitate a visit to A&E, which would bring its own silent traumas. The nearest hospital was Good Hope in Sutton Coldfields, which was, and perhaps still is, known as No Hope. Another example of mid-century provincial modernism. It's where me and my brother were born. It's also where my mum lost a daughter during childbirth in 1981. In an act of callous indifference, she was placed on a ward with the sound of the crying babies of the maternity department to one side and a view of the neighbouring cemetery to the other. I was oblivious at the time, worried only by my own breaks and scrapes, but each visit to that hospital must have been a harrowing ordeal for my mum and dad. All of this was playing out in a city that felt very much past its prime. The hospital, along with great swathes of Birmingham, was heavily redeveloped in the 1960s and 70s. But by the early 90s, it was all fading. The city centre was a broken mess. Part two, Birmingham Central Library. Birmingham Central Library sat on a natural ridge in the civic heart of the city. An imposing concrete structure that offered an austere counterpoint to the whimsy of the neighbouring town hall, which was built in the style of a Corinthian temple. Demolition of the library would begin in 2013, less than 40 years after it opened to the public in 1974, and 1 year after the death of its architect, John Maydig. These nine brick tiles are from a pile of over 600 that are at my studio in Digbeth. I saved them from the demolition process in a failed attempt to have them reused in the new Library of Birmingham as a monument to the old one. As a teenager, I'd knocked about around the outside of the library for years before I ever remember going in. The library had been planned as part of a much larger civic centre, so its footprint was expansive and empty, flanked by the 1980s infill of the Copthorne Hotel on the one side and a sweeping bank of steps on the other. The inverted concrete ziggurat form of the library itself was also hollow. It is suggested there would have been a spectacular installation of plants, trees, and falling water if the initial budgets had been maintained, a hanging garden of Birmingham. However, by the time I first experienced it, the ground floor had instead been sectioned into commercial units. I only remember McDonald's at the Chamberlain Square side and Raphael's, a Roman Greco-themed wine bar at the Centenary Square side. Later, there was a branch of Hooters. Later still, a J.D. Wetherspoons. Going uptown as a child was a big deal. Birmingham may be the UK's second largest city, but its size manifests as a horizontal sprawl. Town, the city centre, was and is comparably small, but brings with that a sense of drama when travelling to it from the suburban edges of the city. Always travelling by bus, we would cash in on the discounted extra value meals that the West Midlands travel ticket provided. On the steps in front of the library, we would eat our McChicken sandwich meals sat next to a statue of Thomas Attwood, Birmingham's first MP, who was positioned like us, slumped as if he too had just taken a break from mooching through the racks of Alive t-shirts and HMV. Fast forward to spring 2005. I was in the last months of a photography degree and was lucky to have a tutorial with Deb Robinson from the New Art Gallery Warsaw. It was Deb who suggested I get in touch with Pete James, head of photography at Birmingham Central Library, which I duly did and was invited to come in and meet with him. I nervously showed him the new work I'd just started at the Longbridge factory in Birmingham. The meeting lasted for hours as Pete talked with knowledge and passion about photography, industry, Birmingham, and stuff that I'd never come across before. Lots of it was work I would later encounter and learn from in the library collection. Pete also gave me some money to buy film and to pay for developing costs. It was a modest amount, but at that time it represented a belief in me and my work and was everything. The meeting would change my life, and the library, this place that had been a backdrop, became central to my work. There was no denying that by 2005, the building looked about as bad as it ever had, with netting installed across the structure to protect pedestrians from falling concrete. It was severely underfunded, but it did work and was always busy. Perhaps because of this neglect, Pete was able to carve out the autonomy to grow the photography collection and to showcase it extensively across the world. It became one of the national collections of photography, and despite the neglect, the library felt like an essential civic space. Working both formally and informally with Pete, I got to continue my education through the incredible collection that he had built. 200 metres from the site of the old library is the new one. The Library of Birmingham, which opened in 2013, is also a ziggurat, the second volume of which is clad in gold and is where Birmingham's archives and special collections are stored. There is a photography collection of deep international significance in the library's golden box, but you would never know. Access is limited and controlled, and the collection sits in a form of stasis. The reasons that led to the demolition of Birmingham Central Library are complicated, but are mostly about money. Although discussions of aesthetics and it being an ugly building were never far from the conversation. These perceived horrors of its brutalist design have been replaced by a new brutality of underinvestment in a library that is too small to contain the books from the building it replaced, too expensive to retain the specialist staff who made the library work. Part 3, the Wolverhampton School of Art. I remember starting art school with a clarity born from the unlikeliness that I would ever be there. I left college at 18 with a barely respectable BTEC qualification in media studies and worked full-time in retail for some years before starting my degree a little before my 23rd birthday. On my first day there, I walked apprehensively past the big Asda and towards the school from Molyneux Street, named after the neighbouring hotel, which also gives its name to the Wolves Ground. Molyneux Street is a hill. The school sits at the top of it and appears at the last moment a bold and heroic structure that is known affectionately as the milk crate. It felt to me like a special place, and I couldn't have been happier to be there. The drudgery of my years working in shops were not completely behind me. I had to work through the course and beyond, but I was on a different path, and in those first days, I knew it was the right one. Our lectures and tutorials in the second year took place in a much less impressive porter cabin that had been dropped into the car park at the back of the school. It was in this shabby makeshift classroom that a couple of conversations with visiting artists galvanised my approach to my work and my belief in the importance of art schools outside of the recognised centres of the art world. In the first tutorial with the photographer Simon Norfolk, I was told that my suburban landscapes were boring. They were boring, but that was the point. And I should instead take the same sort of photographs, but do it in North Korea. The suggestion was as ludicrous to me as it was dispiriting. The second tutorial was with the artist Rupplees Luxemburg, who immediately connected these same landscapes to the much wider context of working class creativity that is forged in the boredom and frustrations of the suburbs and the estates. My friends at Wolverhampton were all from working class backgrounds, from different versions of the boot houses. In the poured concrete and plate glass of the art school, we'd found a place where our lives and experiences were not just accommodated, but given value as the material that would shape our ideas, our work, and our identities. However cliched it may sound, it was life-changing. As I speak, the Wolverhampton School of Art is subject to unprecedented cuts that will see all MA and most BA courses withdrawn. 138 creative courses across the university will be scrapped. I began this text with a haunting as a form of modernist creation at Andrew Peterson's concrete tower in the New Forest. I end here in the concrete milk crate of the Wolverhampton School of Art, and an act of willful cultural vandalism that will haunt generations to come, depriving working class people of the very opportunities that enable me to sit here and talk to you today. Thank you.